So I'm delighted to be joined by Richard Plepler, who is at the helm of one of the greatest creative companies in the world today. So let's just talk a little bit about the business landscape you find yourself in, or the environment we all find ourselves in. We obviously have more choices as consumers than ever before, but it's a confusing world, a lot of new entrants, a lot of new ways to consume media. So talk a little bit about this point in time and how you see the landscape your company's operating in.
Sure. So let me go back 10 years to when I got handed the co-president keys, because it was a very interesting moment, 2007. Sopranos had gone off the air. Sex and the City was going off the air. And in August of 07, the New York Times ran this big front page business section story that said, HBO's competitors say they've stumbled. And it was a very interesting moment in our history because I had to analyze what I thought had gone wrong, where I thought we had stumbled. And what I did really was pretty simple. I just looked around at the landscape and said, you know, I think what happened was we had run one of the great insurgency campaigns in the entertainment industry from the mid-1990s into the early 2000s. We took big, bold bets on things that, quite frankly, nobody imagined could resonate in American popular culture. Things like The Wire, things like Oz, even Sopranos, which many of you know if you're a student of our industry, had been rejected at every major network. And we listened to differentiated voices. We listened to points of view. We bet on insurgents. And we found that you could monetize smart. We found that you could monetize differentiation. And that it wasn't about how big the audience was, it was could we do something that nobody else was doing. So what I think happened to us, and I thought about this, and because I come out of politics as do you, I think in political metaphors, and I said, look, we had just run this great campaign. We had been elected to the top of the cultural firmament, and then we got there, and I think what happened is we liked it up there, and we started playing to stay there rather than remember the voice that brought us to the dance in the first place. So, hubris set in, arrogance set in, complacency set in. And so I distilled it pretty basically to let's just return to our essence. Let's go back and listen for those original voices. Let's go back and remind ourselves what brought us here in the first place. Let's clear out the brush. And by the way, let's wipe the arrogance off our face because it's now a pretty intense landscape. And that's what we did. And you know, and the big question for me when I got that job was, ooh, Sopranos is going on. Ooh, Sex and the City, what are you gonna do? What are you gonna do? And I said, look, there'll be no new Sopranos. There's no such thing as a new Sopranos. It's a sui generis thing, it's not gonna happen again. Here's what there is. There's the next great original voice. In came Lena Dunham. In came Armando Iannucci with Veep. In came Mike Judge with Silicon Valley, right? In came these two guys who had never done one moment of television. David Benioff and Dan Weiss, who did this thing called Game of Thrones. So if we stick to what defines this brand, which is differentiated excellence, you know, Haley Barbour said to me, the former governor of Mississippi and former head of the RNC, said to me, Richard, he said, here's what my wisdom, the main thing is keep the main thing, the main thing. And basically, the main thing, I repeat that to myself several times a day, the main thing is let's elevate the brand. How do we elevate the brand? And if we keep thinking that way in whatever genre we're talking about, and as this becomes more and more relevant, should we build a streaming service? There was a huge debate inside the company about whether or not to do that. We made the right choice, which was that this was, we're gonna add to the pie, we're gonna expand it, we're gonna build a digital business, we're gonna continue to build our traditional business. And then we're gonna make this extraordinary curated content available whenever, wherever, and however you wanna get it. And that's why I think we're fortunate enough to see the kind of growth we're seeing.
So the explosion of content that we're seeing today, Netflix, Amazon, starting to spend billions of dollars. Do you have a strategy to deal with the, or is it really just about, as you said earlier, maintaining that core culture of striving for that and taking risks and, and looking for quality.
Our brand is about the curation of quality. It is not about more being better. It is about better being better. So if you just look at your own lives, you cannot possibly absorb all the content that is out there. I'm in the business. I'm a political junkie. I'm an amateur history buff, and I'm a culture junkie. So I'm constantly gobbling up. And even I, there's just not enough hours in the day. So what are you turning to? You're turning to brands that you trust. And I intuitively felt that Netflix and HBO were going to live very comfortably side by side. And I always felt it was going to be Netflix and HBO, not HBO or Netflix, which is exactly what's happening. They're growing, we're growing. And I think that we have all the resources we need to continue to invest in content and continue to invest in the kinds of talent we want to work with. And what I want to make sure we've got when we put it on the air, I want to make sure it's the level of resonance in popular culture, whether it's Big Little Lies, whether it's True Detective, whether it's, you know, Real Sports, whether it's Hard Knocks, whether it's a Steven Spielberg documentary, a Warren Buffett documentary, whatever it is, if we do that well, we're going to continue to grow.
So culture.
Yeah.
As you said, culture eats strategy for breakfast. What does that mean to you, and how do you try to maintain the culture within the firm?
In order to nurture honest conversations, you as a leader have to really believe that I don't need to be right at the beginning of the meeting as long as HBO is right at the end of the meeting. And in order to do that, you have to model an ability to have a genuine organic dialogue with your team, to be wrong in front of your team, to thank people who have a better idea than you did, and to make sure that you're surrounded by the best talent imaginable so that people can push back all the time and say, I don't think so, or we're missing this. So part of culture is making sure that people treat everybody with respect, making sure that an idea that comes from the middle of the company is treated with as much respect as an idea that comes from the upper reaches of a company. And you have to make sure that people know that that's true. You know, there's two truths to every culture. There's the putative truth of a culture, which is what every culture says. If you brought a bunch of CEOs and you said, how's your culture? Do you have an honest culture? Everybody, oh, we have fully transparent. Oh, yes, people are great. People happy at your place? Very happy at our place. They love it. We took a poll. HR took a poll. 87% of the people want to go. Then there's the emotional truth of a culture. And the emotional truth of a culture is, what do people say when they go home at night, right? What do people say to their husbands and wives, boyfriends, girlfriends, partners? What do they say about what it feels like to be in that place? Am I liberated? Can I grow? Do people want to hear what I have to say? Is there really an opportunity to be heard? And if you have an emotional truth that honors those values, it is amazing the amount of energy that it catalyzes. We just got hacked. And the amount of bandwidth that takes up to protect our property, to protect our people, to make sure we're doing all the right things. I mean, it is so moving to me to have watched our teams work synchronically to do everything we needed to do. And, you know, knock wood, we're getting through this. We'll be fine. It's very annoying, takes time. But the culture, no finger pointing, full uniform support of everybody, legal team, tech team, HR team. I mean, just a extraordinary illustration. And trust. And so I think we've moved as quickly as we have to the other side of this. Is, yes, our tech guys have been brilliant. Yes, our legal team has been fantastic. But the core decision making in my office three times a day, synchronic because of culture.
So let's talk about Game of Thrones for a second. Did you have any idea, it's probably one of the most successful TV shows in history, did you have any idea how big it would be at the time, or did you just think it was worth taking a risk? And why do you think it's been so successful?
I, of course, knew that it would become the biggest show in the history of television. Look, Bill Goldman, who wrote All the President's Men and Butch Cassidy and Sundance Kid, he had a great line about our business, which has some real truth to it. He said, nobody knows anything. And here's what you know. You're making bets on talent. The writers, the auteurs, and I break it down very simply. Is the auteur breathing it or are they thinking it? And you can spot the difference a mile away. You could see that Benioff and Weiss were, this was just oozing out of them. They knew it, they felt it. And what was interesting, when the guys came in, the script was a little bit unique to our core brand. It had a little sci-fi in it. They were, in a lot of the backdrop of the script, they were explaining the sci-fi universe, they were explaining the dragon dynamic. And I remember reading it and saying, geez, this might be a little bit off-brand. Who knows? And in came David. He said, let me make this simple for you. You're a political junkie. I said, I am. He said, let me break this down. This is just about power. It's all it is. It's archetypal power. And I promise you, Richard, in the first 15 minutes, you'll forget where the hell you are. You could be in 10th century France. You could be in 5th century. It won't matter. This is a Shakespearean tale as old as the Bible. Who rules? Who runs? Who gets the kingdom? And they just kind of looked at me and said, we know this inside and out. We know our arc. We know where we're going. And he looked me right in the eye and he said, there are very few things in my life I would want to dedicate 8 years to, but this is one of them. I walked down to my current office where my predecessor was sitting and I said, we bet on the boys. They just owned the subject. And conversely, things that we've had that have not gone as well have been more intellectualized. And they've been concepts that have been thoughtful and interesting, but they weren't viscerally magic. And the biggest word that I keep reminding everybody all the time, it's a simple word, fun, right? And I just add to that construct, smart and fun are not mutually exclusive. You can be smart and fun. We don't want people saying, you know, when we're doing our job right, people aren't saying, oh, I like it. I love that. You know, I listen in the focus groups very carefully. I love that. You know, I love John Oliver. I love John Oliver. You don't hear people say, oh yeah, I like John Oliver. That's what we're going for. We're going for an addict's fix. I want addicts. I want people who become so addicted to the brand that they can't resist it. And that means they got to enjoy it.
Let us open it up to some questions. I'm sure we will get some. Right there, thank you.
So you've mentioned that you worked with a lot of writers, a lot of talented people. I'm a writer myself, and I was wondering, so do you believe that there's any core ingredient in a story that really like makes it, that sells it to people?
I think that there are two things. There has to be a sense of high stakes in some capacity. People have to feel the stakes. In some sense of human identification, whether it's empathy or aspiration, a sense that you're a voyeur inside that world. I think if you look at the great iconic shows, you almost feel either the stakes are very high and that's what locks you in, or you look at the world that they're in and you connect with it in some way, even if it's fantasy, and you see yourself or how you would play in that particular environment. Well, take something iconic like Sex and the City, right? The leitmotif, of course, was so many young women saw themselves as a piece of one of those women. I remember saying, this is gonna be a huge hit because you could see whether you're in Chicago, Cleveland, Indiana, New York, LA, it didn't matter. People were identifying with the characters and they found some empathy in who those characters were. I think the thing that made Sopranos so powerfully resonant, even though they were sociopathic killers, is they were also fathers and husbands. And you almost forgot, because David was such a genius, you almost forgot, and he reminded you and wanted to remind you occasionally not to get too comfortable with these characters because they were sociopathic killers. But you felt Tony Soprano's human gene, right? You felt his fears, his anxieties, his role as a father, his you know, for what it was, his attempt to take a small business and make it into a bigger business. And I think in Thrones, or even Silicon Valley, they happen to be there, they happen to be trying to build something, they happen to be nerds, but they're trying to get the gold ring. So the stakes are high and people can empathize. The reason Silicon Valley locks in so much is it's all about aspiration.
All right, on that note, Richard, thank you very much for joining us.